and welcome to Artistic Adventures. Before we get into our artists, I want to talk just a little bit about art. Now, when artists start off going to school, if they're being trained as an artist, my daughter actually is a third-year art student. In the beginning, they spend a lot of time trying to draw exactly what they see. So they'll bring in models and have them draw exactly what the model looks like, or they'll put together still lifes, or they'll send people out onto the street and draw a street scene, or if they're doing something, even something that's kind of fantastic, if they're trying to draw, for example, a fairy, they'll go through and look at pictures and find a photograph of a woman who looks much like the fairy would look like. They spend a lot of time drawing exactly what they see. Well, once they get farther along, they start going from what they see, you know, with their eyes to what they see in their mind, and artists start to develop their own styles. So our artist today is what's called an abstract artist. His name is Vasya Kandinsky, and I love his stuff, but it's not what you think. But I want to show you, I'll talk more about abstract, but here is an early drawing of Kandinsky when he was in art school. It's just called The Old Village Number 2. And if you look at that, you can see that there's some buildings in the background and a fence and paths and trees and a woman. This has gone beyond drawing exactly what he sees and trying to develop his own style. But this is one of his early works. As times went on, we got into the end of the 1800s, artists were doing a lot of experimenting. Now, here's a work by Picasso. And this is not an abstract work. This is a work that comes before that. If you look at that, it's kind of odd. It's not exactly what you see, is it? But I bet if you look carefully at what is there, you would know what this painting is called. Because we've got, we have something that looks, this is gonna fold, something that sounds, looks like a little bit like a guitar, that looks like music. Here's somebody playing something. This is called the Three Musicians. And this was Picasso experimenting with the style. It was something called cubism, and by cubists were people that tried to put things down into their basic shapes. If you look, we've got rectangles and you know, people that don't look like they do. Well, let me show you a work by Kandinsky that is abstract. What do you think about that? The people who did abstract art, or still do abstract art, there's still a lot of people working in this style, they are looking at shapes and colors and putting them in such a way that they do elicit some sort of a feeling or emotion from us. You know, for some people, I may say, oh, that's horrible. Other people might say, that's really interesting. And artists are always experimenting. So you saw that first picture of Kandinsky where it really was like a nice little village scene. To this, we're going to talk more about, because this actually goes along with something else that we're going to look at later. This is actually called Composition Number 8. But a little bit more about art. I love to go to museums. It's something my family has always done, and we go to the Museum of Fine Arts quite a bit and look around there, and it's so good to see. You know, I like Impressionists and looking at all of the, you know, some of the early religious paintings and, you know, the Egyptian art. It's so wonderful, and we go there and we have a great time. But when we go to the Institute of Contemporary Art, the ICA in Boston, totally different experience. Some of that stuff there is just so weird. Some of it is so cool. For example, we went once, my daughter and I went, and we saw an exhibit that somebody had taken live, like avocados, and had wrapped them in newspapers and put them in a bowl. And they literally sat there till they rotted. And then it was the museum's job to go get another avocado and wrap it in a bowl. But you wrap it in the newspaper and put it in the bowl. It's like, is that art? Or another one we saw, somebody had gone to a thrift store, an artist had gone to a thrift store and had found an old answering machine. And when he plugged it in and turned it on, there were all sorts of messages there on the machine that had never got erased. And so what he did is he played those messages and filmed himself kind of lip syncing to the messages. and made a film of it. And it was like an actor doing these, but he was fascinating. But again, is that art? And let's see, what else? One that my daughter still talks about is we went and an artist had taken a whole pile, like thousands and thousands and thousands of pieces of candy. And they had been put, you know, onto the floor. It started like in a pile in a corner and went over onto the floor. And the idea was that every time anyone came in and took one or moved it or did something, that you created now a new piece of art. And, you know, the thing is, even though some of it is kind of, we've laughed at or we've kind of talked about a lot about is it art, is it not art, it's made us think and it's made us look at art in a very, very different way. So I love going. I love going to see the beautiful works of art. You know, give me a lovely impressionist painting and I'm so happy. It's so pretty. But when I leave, sometimes I don't really think a lot about it except that, wow, that's beautiful. It's bigger than I thought it was going to be, or it's different. But when I go to the ICA, or I go out to the Massachusetts, the MoMA out in Western Mass, that is another one where you go through and it's like, whoa, it's so amazing, these things. It's strange and it does make you think. Sometimes I say, I could do that, but I couldn't because the concept behind some of these are so high. And today we're looking at somebody who's an abstract artist. And sometimes you look at that and you think, you know, why is that considered the same thing as somebody who painted the Mona Lisa or did some of these others? But it all is art. And a lot of times these modern artists make you think about art and make you really think about what they've done in a different way. And it kind of, in a way that we are so used to just looking at things the way we see it, like a beginning art student, just drawing exactly what they see. It makes you look at things in a different way. You know, in a way where we are developing our own sense of what art is. And so we are growing a lot like Kandinsky did. So we're gonna start off with our book, and then we've got some things for us to do. So let me get the book set. Okay, here is our book, and it's called The Colors and Sounds of Kandinsky's Abstract Art, The Noisy Paintbrush. The Noisy Paint Box. Sorry about that. The writer is Barb Rosenstock, and the author is Mary Grandpre, Mary Grandpre is an artist who did the artwork for the original Harry Potter series, so I like her for that too. So here we go. And the publisher is Alfred Knopf, and we thank them for allowing us to share this with everyone. Here we go. Vasya Kandinsky spent his days learning how to be a proper Russian boy. He studied books full of math, science, and history. He practiced piano scales to the marching click of the metronome. He sat stiff and straight and dressed up dinners while the grown-ups talked and talked and talked. Vasya's well-off world was perfectly polite until the day his aunt gave him a small wooden paint box. "Every proper Russian boy should appreciate art," said Auntie. She showed Vasya the correct way to mix colors on the paint box palette. Vasya mixed red with yellow. Then he mixed red with blue. As the colors changed, he heard a whisper, "Sss," louder, "Sss," then louder still, "Sss." "What's that sound?" asked Vasya. "I don't hear a thing," said Auntie. Vasya listened as his brush stirred and swished. The swirling colors trilled like an orchestra tuning up for a magical symphony. "Mama! Papa!" called Vasya. "What a noisy paint box!"
"Silly Vasily," said Papa.
"Stop being foolish," said Mama. Vasya painted the sounds of colors. He spun a bright lemon circle onto the canvas. It clinked like the brightest, highest notes on the keyboard. He brushed a powerful navy rectangle that vibrated deeply like the lowest cello strings. He tossed up jagged swashes of blaring crimson and added cheerful dots of burbling green, clanging orange, tinkly violet. Vasya painted and painted until the colors went quiet.
"Look what I made," shouted Vasya.
"Is that a house?" asked Auntie.
"Is it a flower?" asked Mama.
"What's it supposed to be?" asked Papa.
"It's music," said Vasya, waltzing his painting around the house.
"Come down," said Mama.
"Do some math," said Papa.
"Heavens," said Auntie. "This boy needs a proper art class."
So Vasya went to art class and learned to draw houses and flowers, just like everyone else. As the years passed, Vasya finished school and studied to be a lawyer. He ignored his noisy paint box and lived the way people expected. But Vasya couldn't ignore the sounds of colors singing to him in the streets of Moscow. The canary-colored mailbox whistling as he rode to work, the scarlet sunset haze ringing above the ancient Kremlin walls, an ivory chorus of snowflakes scattered on the sable collar of his overcoat. One evening, suitably steamed and starched, Vasya attended the opera. As the orchestra's music crashed around him, the colors of the noisy paint box twirled wildly in his mind, stomping limes of vermilion and coral, caroling triangles in pistachio and garnet, thundering arches of aqua and ebony, the shrill points of cobalt and saffron. Vasya heard the colors singing. Vasya saw the music dancing. And Vasya was never quite as proper again. He quit his job teaching law and moved from Moscow to Munich to be a painter. He studied with this famous teacher, then that one.
"Is it a house? Is it a flower? What is it supposed to be?" his teachers ask.
Vasya wanted to paint the colors he heard, but maybe the famous teachers knew best. Once again, Vasya put houses and flowers and animals and people into his paintings, just like everyone expected. The teachers were happy. Vasya was not. His artist friends understood. They too were tired of painting pretty landscapes and pretty ladies. They thought art needed to change. "Art should make you feel," Vasya told them, "like music."
"Exactly," said his friends. But none of them knew how to paint feelings until the day Vasya grew brave enough and invited the world to see the paintings roaring from his noisy paint box.
This actually is one of his paintings. He did make one that he wrote sounds. Snapping cerulean points, crunching crimson squares, whispering charcoal lines, Vasya named these paintings after the music he loved. Improvisation. Now, in music, improvisation means you just sit down and play whatever you feel like playing. You don't think about it. In fact, what I'm going to do today is an improvisation. And in music, you sit down at the keyboard, you just play what you feel. No music. Composition. And in music, composition is just a piece of music. It's a different word in art that I find it interesting he used composition. In art, composition means how your painting or your art or your drawing, how it's set up, how is it balanced? Is it balanced? Is it unbalanced? You know, how the shapes all kind of fit together, that's the composition. Another name he used was accompaniment. And that's if somebody is singing or playing an instrument and somebody is playing the piano, they're playing the accompaniment. They're not the main person, but they're supporting the performer. A fugue is a piece of music that has one melody that gets played in different ways, kind of overlapping
and every section of the orchestra or your finger in the piano kind of play the same melody. A movement is just simply a part of a symphony. If you've got a symphony, there normally are three movements or three sections of music that play one after another. And simply, he called one three sounds. With his noisy paint box, Vasya Kandinsky created something entirely new, abstract art. It took a long time for people to understand. Is this a house? Is this a flower? What's it supposed to be? It's my art, Vasya answered. How does it make you feel? In fact, this is the one we were looking at. And I just want to share a little bit. I normally don't read the back, but I think it's interesting. He was born in Moscow, Russia in 1866, and his father was also called Vasily. He was wealthy, and his mother was a noblewoman with a passion for music. Vasily, Vasya is kind of the short name, like if you're called William, you might be called, you know, Will or Willie or Bill. He traveled with his family to Italy and then to Odessa, Russia, on the shore of the Black Sea for his father's health. When he was five, his parents divorced, and Vasya lived with his Aunt Elizabeth, the one who gave him the paint box, while he was finishing school. He attended law school in Moscow, then taught law and economics as an adult. This book is historical fiction. It's historical because it's based on facts. You know, she did the research when she did this, all about the artist. But it's fiction because nobody knows if somebody actually says, is it a house? Is it a flower? She kind of made that up. It's all imagined as it might have been. But Kandinsky did describe hearing a hissing sound as a child when he first mixed the colors of paint that his aunt gave him. He continued to experience sounds as colors and colors as sound throughout his life. It's thought that Kandinsky probably had a harmless genetic condition called synesthesia, although accurate tests to detect it weren't invented during his lifetime. In people with synesthesia, one sense triggers a different sense, allowing them, for example, to hear colors, see music, taste words, smell numbers. Scientists believe that those with synesthesia may have more pathways between the sense areas in the brain, or that their senses communicate in other ways than the people other people don't. There are at least 60 different kinds of synesthesia, and it's estimated to occur in one out of every 5,000 individuals. I think I mentioned last week, I had a friend in college who had synesthesia, who was a musician, and she experienced sound as colors. Rather, where he experienced colors as, you know, hearing sound, the colors, but when she would play, she would hear colors. And I always found that very, very interesting. As an adult, Kandinsky attended an exhibition of Claude Monet's Haystacks. The painting stunned him. It was the first time he saw art that was not realistic, and he never forgot the experience. Later, at a performance of Richard Wagner's opera Lohengrin, he saw wild shapes and colors in his mind as the music played. And they showed that in there, that he went, got all dressed up, and went to hear the orchestra. It was Wagner's opera. At 30, Kandinsky established him as an artist in Germany, and he was the founder of an influential art group, the Blue Rider, and later taught at the world-renowned Bauhaus School. So he painted his first completely abstract painting when he was 44 years old, which sparked a revolution in the art world. So they're pretty cool. I've got some of his work to show you, so I'm going to turn the camera back around for a moment. Okay, so I've got some works of Kandinsky's to show you. Here's one that is not really considered abstract at all, but it shows a totally different style than what he was doing when he was painting that village scene. This is actually Moscow, the capital of Russia. But you can figure out that even though it's is kind of a more modern style, you know, there are buildings and there's a gate and things that you can see. One of my favorite works of Kandinsky, the one I would like in my home, is just A Study in Colors. And this is just called Color Study. He did a few of these, and he used pastels, which are
kind of like crayons, but they're softer. And he used that just to experiment with some colors. That was back in the States when he was experimenting. But I want to go back to that first one we looked at, because what this work of art, what set this off, he called it composition number 8, but it's based on a piece of music. I want you to hear a little bit of this music. The composer, his name is Schoenberg, and as a musician myself, not one of my favorites, he's one that I have to work hard to try to understand. But you can hear how this does kind of, you know, mirror the things. Let me play the...
Playing from Holly's iPhone.
Sorry. So you can hear all that music doesn't have a melody. Schoenberg was doing the same thing with music as Kandinsky was doing with his art at the time. He did a lot. Here's another piece right here he did to a piano work of Schoenberg. And I definitely can see how it does mirror the, it mirrors the, you know, the sound of it. Here's one I really like of his, that you can actually, if you look carefully at that, you can see that there are some things that are recognizable in there. I see a man's face and a few other things in there that are more recognizable. I find it just, his stuff, very interesting. One thing that I have included at the end of, on the, I guess the, at the bottom of this video, is something that there was a Russian composer that he felt a great affinity to, and his name was Modest Mussorgsky. And one thing that he did I thought was really interesting is that he made an animated stage sets. He did a lot of work making the backgrounds for theater productions, but he did a stage set that was animated that went along with the performance of the music. And I've included kind of a recreation. Now, the person that recreated it had computers to work with, had modern things to work with, whereas Kandinsky was working with just old animation where you just do a lot of pictures and they've got photographed. And it would be really cool to listen to. But it's interesting what it is. It's the whole idea that an artist is walking through an exhibition of his own works, and there are 10 paintings that he writes that Mussorgsky has written music for, but in between each of them is something that's called the promenade, and I'm going to play that. Just if you listen to this, this will help you pick it out. So this music right here is the promenade, and it's played by a piano. Now, if you go to hear, like even high school orchestras will play some of this. Or if you go to the symphony or you hear Pictures at an Exhibition is the name of the work, which makes sense. The pictures, the 10 pictures and the artist walking between them. It's done by an orchestra. I've got one I will show you at the end. Mussorgsky wrote it as a piano piece, and that is what Kandinsky would have used to make his artwork that went along with it. And so I've got how that sounded on piano. So this is what's called the promenade. And the way the work works, there's that promenade, it's the artist walking. He's looking at a picture and then the music changes. And then the promenade comes again. He's walking to look at the next picture and then the promenade. So it happens in between everything. But this is what it sounds like, just so you'll recognize it if you choose to do that. Oops, that's still... There you go. this is the artist. He's walking onto the first picture, because this is the opening. But this little bit of music, not as long, appears in between every one of them. So we'll stop that. And then what I'm going to do is an improvisation. I'm going to challenge you to find a piece of music that you like or something that inspires you to draw, whether it's, it can be anything, you know, a favorite song, or you could even go on and listen to pictures at the as an exhibition that I have at the end. And but here's one that in his animation, when he drew this, what he did, they were just a bunch of yellow dots kind of bouncing across the screen. But this is with the music. This is actually, the painting is called The Ballet of the Unhatched Chicks. So that's what I would like to paint to today. I'm going to, I was thinking of using pastels, but I think I'm going to use watercolors. So this is my improvisation. I have no idea what I'm going to do. I'm going to listen to the music and I'm going to just going to paint. So let me get this down so you can watch. And then I have one more piece of Kandinsky to show you at the end. That is the big finale, what he drew for the finale of this work by Mussorgsky. Okay, so it looks like I'm ready to draw, and I'm going to put on the Ballet of the Unhatched Chick. I'm just going to get some water over here, get all ready for this. I'm not even sure what I'm going to do yet, so here we go, Ballet of the Unhatched Chicks. Right, that's all the music I have to go with. And I can see why he made yellow dots on that, because it does just sound like little yellow dots moving around, like in different colors. But I don't know. I don't know why I chose what color I chose or what. So this is a true improvisation. Try it. Find a piece of music and just see what you do with it. That's in the case, I don't have synesthesia, I don't see sounds as colors or colors as sound, but I definitely, when I was listening to that, felt it felt really fun just to kind of play with it. So that is my challenge for you. So I'm going to turn my camera back. Turn my camera back so that you can see. Well, I have one last bit of music, because you can't talk Kandinsky without music. And The Great Gate of Kiev. Now, the version of this I got is actually an orchestra playing it. He would have heard the piano version. And as much as I like the piano version, it isn't as full. It isn't as nice. I had one piano student who could play it. You have to have hands like two times normal to be able to play it on the piano. So this is The Great Gate of Kiev, and the promenade has just happened again, and here is, this is his. So on his animation of this, you see all these little, these are little people in there. They move around inside there. I really highly suggest looking down to the comments below and doing that. I put something else in there that is fantastic. It's called Music Lab, and it's just a free program to experiment with music. But my favorite in there is actually something called Kandinsky. And so you go and you use your, if you've got a pad, you can use your finger, or if it's on a computer, a mouse, and you can go and you draw. Make sure, definitely make sure you draw just an open circle, because when you animate it, that's actually pretty hilarious. But you, the colors and everything, the colors change the sound. So I highly suggest to you, go, if you've got a computer or a pad, get Music Lab on and play. There's other things in there, but try out Kandinsky. The other thing is I suggest everybody go on a trip to one of the museums in the area. I'm just gonna grab this paper because I wrote it down. And don't go, I never go unless I can get the museum pass from the library. The three that that are open now, first of all, the ICA, the Institute of Contemporary Art in Boston, is open. And our passes, if you get the pass, people 18 and under are free. And the pass will get two people in for $5, two people over 18 in. So that's a good deal. The Museum of Fine Arts has just opened. You can walk to the ICA and go in. If you don't have to reserve with them. The Museum of Fine Arts, you do have to reserve. It is open. And our pass allows for two people at $10 a person, or if anybody 17 and under is free. And our other kind of cool local places, the Peabody Essex Museum, and which is also open. People 16 and under are free with the museum pass, and two people, $12 each to get in. So take that pass, save some money. But I suggest go to the ICA. It's it'll be a weird experience. You'll see all sorts of things that are that you'd never expect to see, and it's fun. It'll give you give your family something to talk about if you're laughing at it, but even you're thinking about, you know, why was this put in to a museum? My mom used to take me to a museum when I was a girl, and I would see things and I would say, why is that there? I could do that. But when I thought about it later, it's like, no, I couldn't have done that because I probably would never have thought of it. So I suggest that very highly. So go check out Kandinsky's his animation, and definitely get Music Lab on. And I'm also gonna put a list of some books on art books that are at the library. Right now, there's several really good books if you want to find out more about art and the different kinds of arts, like our abstract art or the cubist art that we saw of Picasso. And I think that's it. All right. Well, thank you very much. Next week we're going to be exploring an artist called Mary Blair. And what she is known for was her work with Walt Disney and the movies. And her big thing was color. So we're going to be doing some things with color next week. So be prepared for that. All right, well, thank you for joining me. Hope to see you next week.